What's going on, everyone? My name is Benjamin Nowak with the Smallmouth Experience, coming back at you with another tips and technique video. And this one here is really going to be focused on fishing around the spawn. So that's your late pre-spawn into the spawn through the post-spawn time period, because this to me is one of the most difficult times to consistently catch fish. So I want to share with you guys the information that I know to help you guys be more consistent anglers in this really tough time period. Now, my buddy Alex Rubb was just up here for about 7 days, and that's really what we were faced with when he was up here. Kind of those fish that were in the late pre-spawn period, starting to move up onto the flats. Then we finally found some on beds, and that's really what we were faced with the entire time that he was up here. So if you guys wanna see how we broke it down and how we did, Alex has some videos coming out. I just posted a video yesterday when we were up catching them spawning. So there's a lot of really cool content that you guys can check out associated with this topic here to hopefully help you guys get a better understanding of how we break this down. Now, one thing you guys will see is me referencing my phone throughout this video. I make show notes and outlines for all of these videos. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start pinning these as the top comment down below. So if you guys want to reference the text that I'm using as my outline, you guys can do that. It'll be pinned as the top comment. It'll give you some links so you guys can go check out like topic videos if I'm talking about fishing a jerk bait or talking about fishing a Ned rig. That'll be linked down there as well. So kind of just accessorial content or kind of extra content that you guys can digest and read as I'm talking about this topic to help you guys understand what I'm actually talking about. So we're gonna start by talking about kind of the definition of what I would consider around the spawn. What really is that water temperature I'm looking for? And typically that's 53 to about 70 degrees. That late post-spawn, when those fish start to get up onto the flats, starts around that 53 degree range when you start to see those fish get up shallow and roaming. One thing you have to kind of keep in mind though is shallow is relative. So if you're fishing a glacier style body of water with 20 plus foot visibility, that might be 15, 20 feet deep. But if you're fishing a really shallow river, that's probably up near the bank, like 5 foot or less. So when those fish start to get up and start to roam those spawning areas, that's what I would consider the late pre-spawn. That's typically around that 53 degree range. And then around the spawn for me really kind of continues into about that 70 degree range when those fish are starting to push back out, kind of get post-spawn. Maybe you have a mayfly hatch going on and these fish start to get kind of loose around those spawning areas and start to move around a little bit. That's really what I'm talking. 53 degrees to about 70 degrees when those fish are up on those shallow flats, relatively shallow flats, looking to spawn, make babies, and not really actually interested in coming up and feeding. So typically where I'm looking this time of year is shallow cover. So I'm looking for boulders, I'm looking for sand to rock transition, somewhere that these fish can spawn, because a lot of times these fish get up on these flats, they get up in the shallow water and they're looking for areas where they can actually make beds and have babies. They're looking for mates, they're looking for that protected area on the body of water where they can kind of spawn and be protected from the elements. That's one of the key things with spawning fish. Typically, they're not gonna spawn in the middle of the lake where they can get beat up by the elements and get beat up by boats. They're gonna look for areas that are a little bit more protected, a little bit more out of the way, where they can kind of get on bed and make a bed, have that area be protected, because their end goal is to make babies, reproduce, and ensure the health of those babies as they go back out into the main lake and they start to like roam around again. One of the really interesting things about smallmouth though is they typically spawn closer to the main lake around harder bottom areas. But kind of a key note here, a lot of times smallmouth are not spawning on straight rock. If you have a straight rock bottom, a lot of times those fish don't want to spawn there. And the reason for that is that rock actually cannot hold their eggs as well as some sort of broken up bottom, whether it's a rock and shell mix or a sand and shell mix. They want some sort of hard bottom that's broken up where they can easily kind of fan out that area and their eggs will stick to the bottom. So harder bottom areas, not straight rock. You need some sort of transition or kind of like crushed up, gravelly, harder sort of bottom. But typically they're not spawning around that straight rock stuff. Now I know a lot of guys think about Cherokee Lake where Andrew Upshaw won that tournament flipping those big boulders. That's a different story because what he was doing was looking for those boulder areas, boulder fields, and flipping in between the boulders where it's a protected area. Still has kind of that crushed rock bottom and those fish are super protected. So you'd flip a Ned rig in there where those two boulders meet, creates a very protected area for these fish to spawn. And inside those boulders, you actually have that crushed up bottom where these fish can kind of spawn and lay their eggs, keep them protected. And those eggs are going to stick down there to that kind of crushed up bottom. So that's just a side note. A lot of people think about spawning smallmouth, think about rock bottom, think about those hard, really like solid bottom areas. But that's typically not just straight rock. It's typically not just straight sand. You want some sort of mix, whether it's a chunk rock with shell mixed in it or a marl bottom with shell mixed in it. A lot of times that's where these fish are going to be spawning. Now, what I want to do is kind of break down what I would consider spawning areas by style of body of water. So I want to start with glacial style bodies of water. And a lot of times glacial bodies of water have what's called a marl bottom. It's this really short style of grass. And what these fish will do is they'll get on that color change, get on that marl bottom, and they'll fan out little beds or round areas where there is some sort of difference. It could be a little depression. It could be near some sort of small contour change, but a lot of times these fish are looking for some small contour change with that marl bottom because that marl is gonna hold that shell. It's gonna hold some heat a little bit better, and it's gonna give those fish a place to really spawn on those glacial style bodies of water that are typically very featureless, where it's just basically a big bowl, a small section of shallow water before it drops back off to the deep. I'm typically looking around those marl bottom areas where it's that kind of shallow perch style grass, different style bottom, small ditches, small contour changes is what these fish are gonna look to spawn on. Another really good area to look on these glacial style bodies of water is around boat docks. A lot of our northern bodies of water have a lot of boat docks around them, and these fish will use those boat docks to spawn on. And the reason for that is one of the very few pieces of cover that actually exists in the lake. So those boat docks, you'll notice maybe where one of the poles hits the bottom, you'll see a smallmouth on bed. And this is a really good area, really good pattern you can run around all these glacial style bodies of water, and these fish will be spawning on those boat docks because it's one of the few pieces of cover in the water. Next, I wanna talk about your rivers and reservoirs, and they typically fish very similarly, whether it's a small river or it's a dammed off man-made reservoir. A lot of times these fish are spawning around shallow visual cover, stuff you can see with your eyes or stuff you can see with your graphic front, whether it's a seawall with a little inside turn or it's, you know, boulders down on the bottom, or it could even be laydowns. A lot of times these fish are gonna be spawning on that very visual cover. You're also gonna be looking for protected water areas. Yes, they'll spawn closer to the main lake, but you're gonna be looking for areas where maybe that current doesn't flow as hard, whether it's a current eddy or a current break. You're looking for areas that these fish can be protected in and spawn on. So those current eddies, somewhere with slack water that is semi-protected, will give those fish a really good spawning opportunity in those areas. A lot of times you're not gonna find them in the main river. They'll be like off the side where there's some sort of current break or current seam. That's where these fish are gonna spawn, whether it's up the arm of a river behind boulders or on that rockier bottom where these fish can kind of get behind something to break that current. That's where these fish are gonna spawn. You gotta keep in mind, when these fish are making beds, their end goal is to ensure the success of their young to make it to adulthood. So typically that's going to be in areas where they can ensure their beds are going to be protected from all of the elements, whether that's current, whether that's predators, predatory fish. They're looking for protected areas where they can go up and spawn really naturally. And finally, I wanna talk about the Great Lakes. And the Great Lakes are really unique because you have so many vast areas that you guys can check. It's just enormous bodies of water that seem very, very endless or difficult to break down. But a lot of times you're looking around shallow flats, like big, obvious shallow flats with that kind of marl or different style of bottom where you have that shell to sand mix, because these fish want to be able to drop their eggs on something protected. Another really, really good and more obvious area to look is islands. I love to fish islands, especially on the Great Lakes, because it provides some sort of protection in a vast ocean, vast giant body of water. Those islands kind of provide that current break, they provide that seam, they provide that protection that these fish are looking for when they're spawning on the Great Lakes. And finally, I'm looking at the connecting rivers. I'm looking at those areas where you have river channels that are connected to the Great Lakes where these fish can push up in and they can spawn up in these kind of shallower, more protected river systems that flow into the Great Lakes. And this is a really cool area to fish because a lot of times you'll get these Great Lakes fish, these giant Great Lakes fish that live on the Great Lakes most of their life. They'll push up into these rivers where they're protected and they'll spawn and then they'll move back out to that deeper water. So it's a really good area, not only for the spawn, but for the pre-spawn and for the post-spawn when those fish are moving back out of the river systems. You can typically catch them at the mouth of those rivers, feeding on bait fish in the pre-spawn and kind of using that river system to move back out into that deeper water after they're done spawning. Again, you're typically looking for that gravel or the mixed sand bottom, not those rock flats. You're not looking for those giant limestone kind of drop off areas. You want some sort of protection, sort of that mixed bottom composition is where you're going to find most of your beds. Keep in mind, I keep saying the spawn, but a lot of times that late pre-spawn, these fish are going to be in those spawning areas. They're going to be up there looking to make beds, looking to get on beds. So the areas that you're going to be keying in on are actually spawning areas that these fish are on, even if they're not physically on bed. So that's what I'm going to be keying in on a lot, pretty much through that late pre-spawn into the post-spawn and through the post-spawn, is where were these fish spawning, where are they spawning, and how are they going to get to and from those areas? Because that's what I'm going to be focused in on. So now that we've talked about when and where, I want to talk about the baits that I'm using during this time to catch a lot of my fish. And I want to start with my favorite one, which is a Ned rig. Now, a lot of people are going to opt for a tube during this time period, but I just seem to get a lot more bites fishing a Ned rig. And I think the reason for that is it's a smaller profile. It's a more natural profile. So these big fish that are pushed up shallow that start to get really finicky and start to kind of turn off of other baits will typically eat a Ned rig all the way through the spawn. So from that late pre-spawn, when they start to move up onto those flats and you can visually see them roaming, you can flip this out there and catch them. When they're on beds, this is a bait that you can flip into their bed and catch them. When they're post-spawn and not really looking to eat, again, this is a bait that you can swim up in the column or you can fish on the bottom and get those fish to bite. For me, a Ned rig is just a very, very versatile bait that looks very natural, smaller profile, smaller presentation that I just throw out there when I need to get bit. And a Ned rig really is that key. So this here is basically a Duet Molds quarter ounce Ned head, and that is a goby made by my buddy, Handmade Fishing. Just a super, super natural looking goby. Can fish it really slowly around those spawning areas and get a lot of big fish to bite. Now the rod that I'm throwing that on is a Tactical Elite TFO 7.3 medium, and I'm throwing it on a 3000 size spinning reel. I like that 7.3, especially when I'm fishing these shallow flats, because I can make a long cast away from the boat and still get a good hook set into those fish with that medium power rod. And then that 3000 size reel just gives me the confidence to make a long cast, and it's a high speed gear ratio, 6:2:1, so I can pick up line quickly and get them moving towards me. So that would be my go-to number one, is some sort of Ned rig. Now, again, like I mentioned, I have the show notes down there in the comment section below for you guys to go check out. You guys can actually check out a full comprehensive Ned rig video, as well as a couple of these other baits that I've already done so far, by going down there, finding the Ned rig topic and clicking on it. It'll take you to that Ned rig video and it'll break down more in depth how I'm fishing a Ned rig. The next bait that I like to throw, and this is very much so a northern thing, is a hair jig. Now, a hair jig is just a very effective way to cover shallow water. And I had a conversation today with my buddy Ross from TFO, and the way he referred to this is basically like a potato chip. You can't just have one, right? This will catch fish when other baits just won't. And the reason for that, it is a super natural sort of do nothing presentation. All you do is make a long cast with this bait and really slowly reel it back to the boat on very light line, and it just looks super natural coming through the water, and you can trigger a lot of bites. And what's interesting about this though is a hair jig for me is really a springtime bait. When those fish get up onto the shallow flats, through the spawn, through the post spawn, when you have that mayfly hatch, and then I'm pretty much done with it. But it's a super effective tool to get a lot of bites this time of year. And I'm just really confident in throwing this thing around those shallow flats. But one thing that I want to note with the hair jig is a lot of times you won't feel the bite. You'll be able to visually see those fish come up behind your hair jig. You'll get to see them kind of track it and trace it. But a lot of times when those fish eat that bait, you won't feel anything. So what you need to do is just keep reeling and then apply pressure, and you're gonna trust that hook to do the work for you guys. It's not a violent strike typically. It's just normally a mushiness or a softness in the rod. You just keep reeling till you feel it load up and lean into those fish. You don't have to set the hook really hard. You risk breaking those fish off on the hair jig. Now the next is a drop shot, and this is not a tool that I use to cover water. This is a tool that I use to pick fish off beds, or if I know fish are congregated or grouped up in an area, I will flip a drop shot into them because it gets a lot of bites. This is a tool where you can suspend a bait in front of a fish when you can see them or you know they're there. And so a drop shot for me is a very much target oriented bait. It's not something I'm going to make a long cast and use that trolling motor or move through the area with, but if I know they're in a very specific spot, I'll flip this drop shot out in front of them and I can hold it in their face till they bite. Now the rod I'm throwing this on is a TFO 713. It's a 7.1 medium light rod, which is something that we're working to come out with, sort of on the way to come out with. Super versatile rod, super versatile setup that will catch a lot of fish. Again, a 3000 size Lose Team Lose Custom Pro reel. High speed gear ratio to be able to pick up that line quickly and get these fish moving to the boat. Now this is where things are going to start to get a little bit different, and it's going to depend on the style of body of water that you're fishing. If you're fishing an inland river or reservoir, I like to fish a swim jig. A swim jig for me is a very, very good shallow water tool to get these fish to bite, whether they're around grass or a variety of different cover boat docks. A swim jig for me really gets a nod. Now, if I'm on the Great Lakes or I'm on those really clear glacial style bodies of water, I will switch this up and go to a swim bait, a paddle tail style swim bait, like a Kitec 3.8 or a Bass Magnet Shifter Shad, kind of like that 3.5 to 4 inch swim bait profile. And the reason for that, in that cleaner water, I don't really like the bulk of that skirt. So what I'll do is I'll take and just run a 3.5 to 4 inch swim bait up on a jig head, 3/8 or a 1/4 ounce jig head, and fish it around really shallow. The rod that I'm throwing that on is the TFO Tactical Elite 735. It's a 7.3 medium heavy, can make really long casts. Then I'm fishing it on a 6-speed gear ratio reel with 14 pound test fluorocarbon line for this entire setup, whether I'm fishing a swim jig or a swim bait. Basically, that is going to be my setup. Want to get as long of a cast away from me as possible. Give those fish as much time to see that bait, key in on it, and eat it before they see the boat. So you want to make really long casts on these flats, and that's a great technique to cover water with. And finally, we're talking about jerk baits or flukes. Now, these are going to be both fished on the same rod for me, but they're going to be really, really similar techniques and very different approaches. So a jerk bait for me is really going to get the nod when it's a little bit windier. When I can't see in the water very well, I can fish this a little bit more quickly, and I can cover water with a jerk bait. I'm going to be fishing that on a TFO Tactical Elite 7-foot cranking rod. And the reason I like this, it has more of a moderate bend. And so it's going to allow me to keep these fish pinned on a long cast with that moderate bend. And it's a medium powered rod. Really, really good for jerk bait fishing. Now, if it's a little bit more slick and I can see a lot further in the water, I'm going to pick up a fluke. And this is something Alex did quite a bit when he was up here. And he smashed me on it, was fishing a fluke in that shallow water. Now, why is this so effective? It's because he can fish it more slowly and he can basically pick pieces of cover apart. So if you see a boulder a long ways away from the boat on a shallow flat, you can take this fluke on a little 4-aught EWG style hook, cast it, kind of hang it over that boulder and wait for those fish to come up and tag it. A fluke is just a really good way to get a lot of bites from those shallow cover oriented fish. Now, where the jerk bait for me is a windy water approach or windy day approach, a fluke is sort of like that more clean body of water or less windy day approach when I'm target casting or target fishing these shallow kind of spawning areas. And the colors that I'm going with are really bright and bold. I'm going with the chartreuse color or bubblegum. Either one is really going to work. These smallmouth, they just can see it from a long ways away in that shallow, clean water situation. And that fluke just gets a lot of bites for me. So I'm either fishing a jerk bait or a fluke when I'm up there on those shallow spawning flats. And that's really how I do it. Those are the baits that I use. That is what I use to approach a lot of these shallow areas and how I pick these spots apart. Now, when I find these fish on beds, that's really where I'm going to slow down and fish like a drop shot or fish a Ned rig and kind of drag it in front of their face. But these are smallmouth on beds. Typically pretty aggressive, and they'll spawn around that 58, 59 degree mark, pretty much up until 65, 66, 67 degrees. You're sort of looking at that upper 50s to mid to upper 60s as your spawning, prime spawning time frame. And that's when I'm gonna pick up my Ned rig and my drop shot and whatever else you guys wanna catch them off beds with. They're not hard to catch. Just flip your bait in there, back the boat away so they can't see you, wait for your line to start swimming to the side and you can set the hook. It's just a really fun way to catch fish. But you have to be really careful when you're doing that because you don't want to stress these fish out. Now, I want to end this thing by saying one thing and giving you guys kind of a PSA. When you're fishing this time of year, be cognizant that this is a time of year when fish can get very stressed out very easily. They're going up shallow to do one thing and one thing only, and that is make babies and protect their beds. So when you flip a bait up on a bed and you get that fish to bite and you get him in the boat, I hope you land a giant, but take a picture of that fish, get it on a scale, and then release it as quickly as possible. Reduce the amount of stress that you're putting on these fish, and I would recommend not putting them in the live well unless you absolutely have to. Unless your buddy's doubled up on one, you don't want to hold that fish out in the open air. Put them in your live well, net your buddy's fish, get that fish out, take a picture, and let them go. Let them go as quickly as possible, because this is a time of year when you can catch some trophies. You can also have some fish die on you if you're not careful. So be as careful as possible. Keep them out of the water for as short of a period of time as possible. And just go out and have a lot of fun. If there's any questions or comments about anything in this video, please let me know down in the comment section below. If there's a certain topic or technique you guys want to see me talk about in future videos, go down there, find the comment section, let me know what you guys want to see, because it makes sure I'm making the videos that you guys actually care about. Again, if you're not already subscribed, please hit that subscribe button. As always, thank you guys for watching. Take care, tight lines. God bless. Pursue your passion.